beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Amen.
I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgave me for my sins.
Almighty God, merciful Father,
I am a wonderful sinner. Confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you with your kindness and mercy, and for the sake of all the innocent of their sufferings and death, of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being.
Father, through confession, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And instead, by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity and the undivided unity. I have set the Lord always before me.
Because he is at my right hand, I shall not be shaken.
Therefore my heart is glad and my whole being rejoices.
My flesh also will not fear.
For you will not abandon my soul to Sheol.
For that your Holy One is seeking corruption.
You make known to me the path of life.
In your presence there is fullness of joy.
Thank you.
grace to acknowledge the glory of the eternal Trinity by the confession of the faith, and to worship the unity and the power of the divine majesty. Keep us steadfast in this faith and defend us from all adversities. For you, O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, live and reign, one God, now and forever.
Creatures and let birds fly above the earth across the expanse of the heavens. So God created His greatness is unsearchable. On your wondrous works I will meditate, and I will declare your greatness. The second reading is from Acts chapter 2. Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and addressed them. Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with mighty works and wonders and signs that God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves know. This Jesus, delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men. God raised him up, loosing the pangs of death, because it was not possible for him to be held by it. For David says concerning him, I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand, that I may not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad, and my tongue rejoiced, my flesh also will dwell in hope. For you will not abandon my soul in peace, or let your holy one see corruption. You have made known to me the path of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. Brothers, I may say to you with confidence about the patriarch David, that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Being therefore a prophet, and knowing that God had sworn with him an oath to him, that he would set one of his descendants on the throne, he foresaw and spoke about the resurrection of Christ, that he was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh see corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that we are all witnesses. Being therefore exalted at the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured out this that you yourselves are seeing and hearing. For David did not ascend into the heavens, but he himself says, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at your right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. Let all the house of Israel therefore know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom we crucified. This is the word of the Lord.
Eternal,
but one eternal.
Father is Lord, the Son is Lord, and the Holy Spirit is Lord.
Amen.
Just as we are compelled by the Christian truth to acknowledge each distinct person as God and Lord, so also are we prohibited by the Catholic religion to say that there are three gods or lords. The Son is neither made nor created, but begotten of the Father alone.
The Holy Spirit is the Father and the Son.
Thus there is one Father, not three fathers, one Son, not three sons, one Holy Spirit, not three Holy Spirits.
Amen.
And for the extroverts,
Isolation and that sense of being alone is like driving a car with a hole punched in the fuel tank. No matter how you try to top that tank off, your fuel just keeps spilling out and you cannot navigate properly. No matter where you find yourselves on this ambivert scale, countless people are feeling very alone this spring. When God created Eve for Adam, he said, "It is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a fit helper for him." And man does not live on bread alone. Neither is he supposed to eat it in isolation. So what does that have to do with the festival of the Holy Trinity? It has everything to do with being created in the image of Almighty God. And God said, "Let us create man in our own image, after our likeness." Scripture shows us that to be made in the image of God is to be made to love, because God is love. It also means to be made holy, because God himself is holy. We lost that when our first parents fell into sin. But with our baptisms, the Holy Spirit has begun to restore that image in us. But it will not be completed until the last day, when the last vestiges of sin are finally destroyed as our Lord comes again in glory. But there is another aspect of the divine nature that God has bestowed on us by forming us in his image. And that aspect is community. Because God himself is not alone. Now, no matter how long or hard we search the Bible or read the works of very nimble-minded theologians, we will never, ever comprehend the mystery of the Holy Trinity. Our God is three in one, one eternal God outside of time and space, yet three distinct persons in unity and community together. When God spoke the universe into being when there was neither time nor light, he did it alone as God, but God was far from lonely. We see God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit communing together at the dawn of creation. Again, we cannot comprehend that. But God is not talking to himself. The three persons of the Trinity speak in fellowship to one another in the creative act. Before it, there was only God. And after it, now the newborn universe communing with God. And the climax of that creative act was, of course, God's creation of us in his image. Created in the image of God for the purpose of loving him and loving each other. Such a society must then be a holy thing as it was created by God. And we were given dominion over the entire creation to benefit our neighbors in our various locations. When sin entered the world, not only was that God-given holiness broken, the image of outpouring love was lost, and our new normal behavior became one of selfishness, greed, and hostility. The invisible corruption of sin is like our cosmologists' search for what they call dark matter. They cannot see it, they don't know what it is, but its effects are visible. The dark matter takes other matter off of its course than it would normally mathematically take. Simply, we barricade ourselves into mental and at times physical fortresses of solitude, where we are the masters of our own self-created bubble universes, and thus isolated and alone at the center of our little bubble. We have eyes only for ourselves. How truly far from the grace and image of God we have fallen. But like the unseen force in the universe which gives weight to all things, God's unfathomable power brings us back on the course of holiness and blessedness, undeserving sinners that we are. God the Father sent his beloved Son, the Word of God, the force of creation, into our flesh, into the form of appearing to be like one of his created, the perfect God-man, Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ, in his human form, shows us what the unseen
unsullied image of God looks like. The immeasurable greatness of God's power for us is Christ's sacrifice for you. Because once Jesus conquered sin and death, the Father raised him to the highest seat of heaven, above all else that was created for every age to come. He is our head, and we, his church, are his body. Since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise partook of the same things, that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is the devil, the writer to the Hebrews wrote. Despite our sin, God forgives and renews us for the sake of Christ. No matter how many times we are wasteful, or how great a destructive force we are in the world, or how often we sin against our neighbors and our families, or repay our neighbor's sin in return, God will forgive us for the sake of Christ, if only we believe. Every day we have a new opportunity, with the aid of the Holy Spirit, to rebuild all of those relationships and to create new ones. We're not made perfect children, not yet, but we can begin to return to that childlike trust, faith, and even awe at the blessings that we have been given. In reaction to it, we can begin to imitate God's image. Our sin remains, but we need not fear abandonment and punishment. There is no sentence of isolation from God any longer. Jesus bore that aloneness, that cut-offness from the Father and the Holy Spirit. He experienced that hanging on the cross and died under the weight of it. The saying is trustworthy, for if we have died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we also will reign with him. If we deny him, he will deny us. If we are faithless, he is faithful, for he cannot deny himself. In an astonishing reversal to the isolation that we have incurred from this coronavirus, activists have turned out in droves to protest the death of George Floyd, to protest wrongful death everywhere. Not only here, but they're protesting throughout the world. Now, of course, being sinners, not all of those protests have been peaceful. Many, in fact, have displayed anything but Christ-like attributes. But those are the ones you have seen on the evening news and in the papers. If you search it out, you will see the hundreds of peaceful protests. And we know that the people rioting are not really doing it for George, but themselves. What about the thousands of others who cut across all socioeconomic lines to protest this killing and injustice throughout the world? Many of those people are not people you would ever picture at a rally in this way. Why is that? Has our sequestering made everyone so bored that they are willing to leave the house to do anything? Is it because people suddenly have their time? Those are ridiculous statements. Is God using the cabin fever that's been caused by this pandemic to shine a light on injustice? Has God used our isolation to rally people together for a common cause? Those are more likely. Whatever the reason, too many people have set aside their differences and ignored their fears to take action. They've gathered together as a community of activists on a global scale. Righteous indignation, not fueled by hate or anger, though those emotions are present, but love for one another, to look out for one another's freedoms. God created man to live together in this way, to glorify him together, to lift one another up together. We glorify God when we allow the Holy Spirit to do his work. We glorify God when we call him Father and seek his forgiveness when we do wrong and when we fail to do what's right. We give God glory when we humbly accept his gift of life, both here and in eternity. And like a good parent, the Father forgives us and loves us despite ourselves.
The Son paid your debts. He took your punishment. And the Spirit makes you believe it. And the communion of saints is where we gather to worship Him, to receive the medicine of eternal life, to regain His image. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. See all that our triune God has ordained for us. How will you take that fellowship back into your community today? Because despite appearances to the contrary, you are not alone. God does want to have a special, personal relationship with each one of you. And He does it in the name of Jesus. Amen. May the peace which passes understanding guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
All these things pray you to grant us, Father, for the sake of our Savior Jesus Christ, through whom, with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, both now and forevermore. Amen.
Thank you.
Christ through the same, in faith for you and in fervent love for one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Spirit
will be from 2 to 5.